mechanism. I'll also talk about the sequence to sequence model, where we have encoder decoder kind of an architecture with attentions. Just an audio check. I hope you guys are able to hear me.
Yes, we are able to hear you.
Cool, cool. So sequence to sequence models with attention is something we'll discuss shortly. Then finally, we'll go to the conclusion and the code walkthrough part. I'm also attaching some reference link if you guys want to have a detailed explanation of whatever we'll be discussing today. Okay, so let's start. You can see a very simple diagram of an RNN. What exactly is RNN? So basically, it's a class of artificial neural networks, which majorly works with sequential data, like audiogram and speech and something of the sort, which has some sequence into it. The output from previous step is fed into an as an input to the current time step, which we can see in the unrolled version of RNN in the diagram here. We can see at each time step the input is the x, and the input to the next time step is basically the x1 or xn, and the hidden state of the previous time, of the previous time step. It can be thought as a multiple copies of same network, each passing a message to its successor. And most importantly, as I mentioned, is the hidden state, which remembers some information about a sequence. So that is something differs from the traditional neural network architecture, where we just have input and output and hidden nodes. But here, there is some looping mechanism in the hidden state area. Now let's try to understand and build intuition for an RNN. You can see a snapshot of a ball. This is not moving, currently it's a static ball. And if I ask you to predict the direction of the ball movement, will you be able to tell me in which direction this ball is moving just by looking at the static image?
No.
Yeah, it is not possible to just predict the ball movement direction. But let's see this. Now, since it is moving in a particular direction, there's a sequence, a particular order in which one thing follows the other. And with this information, we are able to judge the ball movement direction, because our eyes are able to capture at every time step the ball movement direction. And this is kind of an intuition behind RNN. If you give RNN a sequence of steps or a sequence of data, it will help us in generating the next possible sequences, or what is the next possible output in that sequence. What other form of sequence data that you can think about? I also already mentioned about the audio data, right? Audio spectrogram can be divided into chunks and then fed into RNN. And again, we can apply RNN mechanism in the audio world or in the audio data sets and get output. Let's talk about another intuition. If we try to say the alphabets in this order, A, B, C, D up to Z. Or Z. Yeah, I mean, I think it is simple for every one of us, because from our childhood, we are kind of talking and we are listening and learning in this order. But what if I tell you to read this alphabets in a reverse order, starting from Z up to A? I think all of us will find difficulty in reading and telling about the alphabets in the reverse order, right? Why do you think is this happening? Because we have memorized in a way, in a particular order, and suddenly if you ask me to tell the same thing in reverse order, our brain will not be able to pick up that pattern, and that's the reason we're not able to speak the same thing in a reverse order. Okay, what if I ask you to start in between, let's say from letter F? I think what will happen is we will be able to kind of struggle initially in the first 2-3 letters, but suddenly we'll start picking up pattern and we'll be able to complete the rest of the alphabet sequence. This is because, I mean, if I have to mimic the same thing as a human, even we understand and recognize sequence patterns, and same applies with the RNA systems as well. It is able to pick up the sequence patterns, and hence the center of RNA is the sequential memory or sequential data. Let's move to the RNA structure, and we want to understand how exactly the sequential memory concept is brought into RNA. If you look at the normal neural network architecture, we have input and output nodes, and we also have hidden units in between. This is a normal feed-forward neural network architecture. But how do we ensure that we keep the information of the previous state or time step and in this architecture? How do we do that? What if we add a loop in the neural network that can pass the prior information forward? So if we have this kind of a looping structure where we can pass on the previous information to the next time step, I think this will go. And that's what we want, right? We want the hidden states to pass their state information to the next time step. So RNA gives this looping mechanism that acts as a highway to allow information to flow from one step to the next time step. That's what we want, right? Okay, I'll take a pause, and if anyone has any question till now.
No, at least I don't have till now.
Yeah.
You have taken very nice examples to explain the sequential process.
Yes. Yes, I thought that this can build some intuition.
Yes.
If I had thrown the formulas, that would have been difficult.
It has become easy for us to understand the concept.
Yes. So with that, let's move to the example part. So let's consider an example where there's a chatbot, and it kind of takes in the input by the user. Let's say an Alexa example, and if you ask something to Alexa, it will do something in background, and it will output you something, right? So let's, in this example, in this GIF, you can see the user is asking about something about weather in some long sentences, but the chatbot is able to understand the intent behind this, and that intent is asking for weather. So how do RNN kind of achieve this feat, right? Let's take an example, and let's understand that part. So what RNN will do typically, it will take in the long sentence, the sequence of text using RNN, and once the RNN processing is done, whatever output is generated from RNN, it will feed to the feed forward neural network to classify intents, right? So obviously we will have that kind of training data available before we feed into RNN, where we have the text and the intent. We have these two things as a training data, which is going into RNN and FFNN, and it will do it. But just to explain and understand this chatbot example, assume that we are, how the way we are decoding all these things, okay? We are filling in the sequence of text into an RNN, and we're taking that RNN output to a feed-forward neural network to classify intent. So just to elaborate on these two steps, we'll move to the next slide. So the encoding step, right? How it will encode? First, it will break whatever sentence that you are asking into words or chunks. So here the chunk is what time is it and question mark, okay? So we are breaking the sentence or into word sequences and feeding the words one by one, one word at a time. So in the first iteration or first loop iteration, we will feed the what part of it. In the next time step, we will feed what, we'll feed time as the word sequence, as well as whatever hidden information or a context that we have received from word what. So now RNN has information about two words, time and what both, right? Also notice the color changes that are happening within that circle. Just have a tab on it or look on it as we move to the next slide. In the next subsequent time steps, you will see that it has encoded all the words along with information from the previous word. Also look at the color changes that are happening within the circle. Now the RNN has information about all the words. Now what next? What it is doing is, at the final time step, that is 05, once it has received all the context information of all the words in the sequence, it is taking that information, passing it to the feed forward neural network and classifying it. Okay, that is how the RNN would work typically, taking in the context from all the words in the sequence, and that context is passed to the feed forward neural network to classify a particular intent. So here the intent is asking for time. Okay, if I have to write a pseudo code of an RNN, what it would look like? So this is the pseudo code that you are able to see in my screen. What we are doing here is, we are initializing the RNN. That is one thing that we want. We are also initializing the feed forward neural network and some initialization of hidden states, which is initialized to zeros. The forward loop or the for loop that I was talking about, that in terms of code, it would look like this. What I'm doing is, at every loop iteration, I'm passing on the words and the hidden state. Since for my first word, I'm passing the hidden state as all these zeros, right? We don't have anything previous to the first word, so we pass on the zeros, and as it iterates through the loop, for loop, it is outputting the output values and the hidden state. This hidden state is again taken in the next for loop iteration, and this way we are passing the hidden state, the context for every words. At the end, once the for loop is over, it will take the output and it will use for the prediction, and we will pass on this output to the feed forward neural network. I think what we saw in the animations in the previous slide, if I have to put in terms of code, this is a very basic pseudocode it would look like. What I want to highlight here is, let's say I'm not using word comma hidden state in the Python code you're able to see. I'm not using word comma hidden state, but what if I use word comma previous word? And if I have to generalize that statement, you can see the last line in the slide. Let's say if we have input plus previous hidden, going to the hidden time step and going to the output. If I don't use this, if I use input plus previous input, what would happen? That is a question to everyone. I'll take a pause for 10 seconds if you want to kind of ponder on that. Is this Jason?
Yes.
You are speaking. If you are speaking, I would want someone else to speak.
Okay. So, can anyone answer this question? Yes. So I think
I have asked too early for everyone to join this meeting. Yes. I think half of them must be so sorry for
that. Yes, you have joined early. Late, so they must be catching right now what's going on.
Okay.
Yeah.
No problem. Let's move to the next slide.
Yes.
So I was talking about what if we input input as well as the word as well as the previous word instead of word as well as the hidden state. So can you notice the color changes? What I'm depicting here is four time steps in RNN cycle. Look at the hidden layer recurrence and look at the input layer recurrence. Okay. If I use the input, let's talk about input layer recurrence and see in the last time step, in the hidden structure, you see that the colors HID is what the four time step is giving to it. And DEN is just above that, right? You can see if I use input layer recurrence, the final hidden state that I want to pass on to the feed forward neural network will only encompass or comprise of the last two words that I'm putting into it, right? Do I want to just put last two words or last two time step in the final hidden state? I believe no. But what we actually want is an entire context of all the words that have come in my sequence. And that essentially is achieved by the hidden layer recurrence. If you see the hidden layer recurrence, the final hidden word that you see in the fourth time step, it is, if you see the color coding, it has taken the essence of all the inputs that is being fed in the RNN, all the word sequences. So that is what we are able to achieve if we don't input the word and the previous word, because at the end, it will just take the last two words that it has seen and will output in the hidden state. So the context is just last two words. And that is not what we want to do. What we want to do is we want to have an entire context of all the words present in the sequence. So hence and that's the reason we are using this hidden layer recurrence. Again, this is not a technical explanation, but I think intuitively, if you want to understand, this color coding kind of information will help you kind of build an intuition on why we use the hidden states. Okay. As I mentioned, I was talking about this color information that I wanted you to kind of have a look. This is where we are discussing about the problem with RNN. We can see this odd distribution of words. So can you see in the color information, the word what and time has very little presence in this circle, but the information for is it and question mark is kind of heavy in the entire circle. Why this is happening? If you must have heard about vanishing gradient problem. So while it moves down for the word sequence, it has trouble retaining information from the previous step. Okay, so it starts degrading, the information starts degrading as it moves down to the gradient step where it is learning for word sequences. And at the end, sorry, I just missed the last part. Yeah, at the end, the what and time word is almost negligent or non-existent at the final step. The problem is if we have two long sentences, for shorter sentences, RNNs are quite good. But if you have a very long sentence, there's a possibility that it will start forgetting things which had come previously in the longer sentences. So just for an example, in this use case that you are seeing in the slide, the word what and time is becoming negligent as it is moving down out of the longer sentences. So what we want to do is we want to avoid this kind of scenarios. If I would explain what this gradient means is that if you know how we update the weights for all this neural network architecture, what we essentially do is we get a weight and we subtract from that weight the learning rate into the gradient step, right? So if that gradient is becoming minute as it moves down to the time steps during the back propagation, it will become so small that there will be negligible difference in the weight. And if there's a negligible difference in the weight, it has not learned, right? It has not learned the nuances of the pattern. And essentially the words that are coming in the beginning will start getting deleted or omitted, and it will not have any context of those words. So that is what I have written here. It occurs when the gradient shrinks as it back propagates through time. So the layers that get small gradient updates stop learning. And as a result, RNN fails to learn long range dependencies across time steps. So this is a problem with RNNs. And hence there was a need for some mechanism where we can only pass on in the context vector that we are passing at the final time step. It should only pass relevant information, or we need some kind of a levers or a mechanism to stop overwrite some information which is not relevant and pass on the important information. So that kind of solution was required. So before I move on to ILS teams, which is the solution for this, I'll take a pause and if you have any queries.
So this problem of vanishing gradient, most of the researchers face this problem.
There's a lot of background noise, Jaisal. I'm sorry.
Yes, someone's mic is unmuted, I should check. So how can we overcome this problem of vanishing gradient?
Yes, so as I mentioned, what we want to do is we don't want to pass the entire context vector, right? We want to kind of tap in the context vector and only take relevant items from there, which is meaningful in the longer sequence, right? I don't want let's say if I have a long sentence where a person is talking about a gender and then there are some very weird words that are coming. I only want to retain the gender information so that I can do the correct pronunciation of a word in my subsequent sentence. So I don't want to retain anything which is not useful, and I only want to retain something about a gender. This is just a big example. So how can I achieve that, right? So I need some mechanism to tap in the context vector and only pick up the information about gender and throw away the other information. So that's what we'll be discussing in the LST. Does that answer your question?
Yes, yes, yes.
Sir, this yes. is Dhaval Bhoi, and I would like to ask question that can we apply RNN for doing sentiment analysis?
Yes, you can apply RNN for sentiment analysis. Again, I mean, you need to check. See, people have applied RNNs as well. And people are using LSTM. I am using LSTM for using sentiment analysis. And typically, if you see sentiment analysis kind of topics, what will you have in your training data? You will have longer sentences, right? Let's yeah. speak about Amazon product review. Let's say you have bought iPhone Mini, which is a recent launch, and you have a data set about its reviews. Okay. You will not have a 3 to 4 words sentence. You will have a typically longer sentences.
Yes.
So in that use case, my suggestion would be to check how RNN is working for you. And if it is not performing well, as a next step, you should take a hit on LSTM and see. Again, okay. I mean, these days there are so many new algorithms that have come up. I mean, it's like every 3 months you have to learn a new algorithm or yes, a new
I saw model. Few papers where people are trying various permutation combination kind of thing, various techniques. They are even hybriding those techniques.
Yes. I mean, as I mentioned that this field of text NLP is so dynamic that every 1 or 2 months we have a new benchmark that is coming up, and majorly from Google and Facebook and I mean, OpenAI and all these people are bringing up so many new things, so many new language models and frameworks. So nowadays it's just like a plug and play. Even the amount of code that we used to write earlier and now, it is just a plug and play now.
Thank you.
Okay. Any more questions before we switch on to LSTMs?
Sir. Can you give me some small example by which I can understand about vanishing gradient? I'm still not able to understand, because ultimately we are passing the data, the previous hidden state information, to the next one. So, I mean, how is it lost? I mean, how is it diminishing?
Okay. So, if you have, if you know the how RNNs work and how does it backpropagates, while it is backpropagating, hello, my audio is clear, right?
Yes, it's clear.
Okay. So, if you are able to visualize how the backpropagation works, basically we are kind of taking a partial derivative as we move to the from right to left, right? And as we compute the losses, that computation is being passed on from one time step to the other. If there is a minimum loss at the beginning on the right hand side, it will have a ripple effect as we move to the left where the previous words were coming. So this way, it will start diminishing. The deltas start diminishing, and when it comes actually the first word, the gradient is so small because it has gone to through so many time step. The gradient has become so small. That's the reason when we update the weights, as you can see the formula above, the gradient becomes so small that it is not able to make a major impact in the new weight. So 2.0999 and 2.1 is, there's no difference in that. Why? Because the gradient has become so small. So I think I don't have a visual information for that, but if you're able to visualize the back propagation step where we take derivatives and we compute the deltas and gradients, as it moves from the last time step to the first time step, the gradient becomes shorter and shorter and shorter. And as it comes to the first time step, it is very small. And hence, the weights are not updated and the weights remain the same and it actually stops learning. So if I have updated the weight to say, let's say 3, as I moved from the forward propagation and back propagation, it has remained 3 all day long. Was I able to answer your question?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay, cool. Let's move to LSTMs.
So there's one question which Mr. S.P. Rawal has asked in chat box. Which type of applications are best for RNN?
Any application which has shorter sentences or shorter dependencies. Stop prediction, maybe. See, okay. I mean, RNNs, LSTM and GRUs, you can try in sequence. You can first give a try on RNNs. And if you see that, okay, the main reason it is not working is because of the long sentences that is coming in my data, then you should move to LSTMs.
Okay.
Hope I have answered that question.
Yes.
Okay. Now let's come to LSTMs. What is the major difference? I think the image depicts the major difference. It has, all of them has repeating modules, but RNN has a 10H layer and LSTM has four neural network layers. And all of these four are doing something to retain the important information and to throw away some negligent information and pass on to it to the next time step. So let's deep dive into it. Again, LSTMs are a flavor of RNN, capable of learning long-term dependencies. It was introduced by Hochreiters and Smeed Duppers in 1997. In the standard RNN, as you can see, the repeating module has a simple structure which has a single 10H layer. Okay, let me ask a question. Why do we need a 10H layer? Anyone apart from JSON?
So activation functions are used in these architectures. So this is a kind of an activation function, 10H.
Yes, 10H is an activation function. So just to give an explanation, 10H basically squashes your values, whatever output you get in the individual layers, it squashes or limits your value to -1 and 1. What about sigmoid? What are the limits for sigmoid? Sigmoid use kiya rahega na? Sigmoid layer. Logistic.
Yes, so I haven't used, but I know sigmoid, 10H and ReLU, all these are activation functions.
Yeah, so 10H essentially squashes the value between -1 and 1, and sigmoid, or we can say logits, yeah, it squashes between 0 and 1. right? If you have binary kind of an output, and when you use the logistic regression, yeah, you're essentially using a sigmoid function to limit your whatever regressed value to 0 and 1, limit it to 0 and 1. But in case of 10H, you're limiting it to minus 1 and 1. Okay, this we are doing because we don't want to explode our weights as you move down to different time steps. Because if, let's assume, if we are continuously multiplying it at each time step by a factor of 3 or by a factor of 5, it will explode, right? At the end of the time step, the values will explode. So it's important for us to kind of normalize or between minus 1 and 1. That's why 10H is also called as a squashing function, or you can say, yeah. So we have a 10H layer in the single RNN structure, but we have something else, a lot of things in LSTM, which is interacting in a very special way. That's what I've written here. Okay, let's understand the core ideas behind LSTMs. We have two things here. One is the cell state, and other concept is the gates. So before we actually start talking about the different steps in LSTM, before we start with the walkthrough, let's first understand what cell state mean. What are the concept of gates? So what is cell state? It is a horizontal line that you can see that is just going through top of the diagram. You can visualize or see or understand it in a form of a conveyor belt, where the context information is flowing, and it's on us to kind of tap in and see what kind of information that we want to pick up. So for us, it's just a conveyor belt. As you can see in the outputs, the data, the baggages are flowing, the data is flowing in this context, and we need to do some interaction with it, some linear interaction with it, so that we can only pick up relevant information. Okay, how do we do that? How do we tap this conveyor belt? And that we can do in the form of gates. So the next concept is gates. It is a way to optionally let information through, as what actually gate means literally as well. Yeah. So composed of a sigmoid neural network and a pointwise multiplication operator. Again, as I mentioned, sigmoid layer outputs number between 1 and 0, describing how much each component should be let through. 0 means nothing and 1 means everything. So it will output, the gates will output in the form of zeros and ones and in between values. If it is extreme and zero, it will not allow anything. And if it is one, it will allow entire information to flow through. So these are the two essential components to understand the LSTM structure. One is a cell state and one is a gates. Just a recap, cell state is like flowing the context information in a conveyor belt, and the gates are an optional elements which will allow the information to pass through or it will not pass through, depending on what the sigmoid is outputting. Okay. Let's get into the LSTM architecture and focus on the individual components. As a step one, what are we trying to achieve? As a step one, we are only focusing on what information we should throw away from this LSTM, right? And how are we doing that? We are taking the input XT, that is the input at the current time step T, and along with that, we are also taking the hidden information or the context information from the previous time step T minus 1. We combine these two elements, these two data points, and pass on to the sigmoid layer. What output we get is the information called as forget gate layer. Why do we call this forget gate layer? Because this essentially is talking about throwing away some of the cell state information. Okay. As I mentioned, it will look at XT and H of T minus and output a number between 0 and 1 for each number in cell state. 1 means completely keep this, 0 means completely get rid of this. If I have to take an example to explain this time step, let's assume that we are building a language model. Language models are essentially a NLP kind of field where we want to predict the next word given the context information. So if I want to predict a next word using RNN, LSTM, sorry, in such problem statements, the cell state might include gender of a person for correct pronunciation, which is flowing through the conveyor belt. And suddenly, if in the entire sentence, I'm talking about some new person in the current context, I don't want to have the gender information of the previous person or the old person, right? If I'm talking about something in the current context about a male, I don't want the context of a female who have already come in the previous sentence, right? In the previous time steps. So in this scenario, we want to throw away gender information, and that can be achieved using the forget gate layer. What actually it is taking as an input, it is taking the current time step as well as the hidden information from the previous steps. We pass on this to the sigmoid layer and get a value as FT. FT is nothing but the forget gate layer output. Now let's see how this will be utilized in the subsequent step. And let's move to step two. Again, one, we have dealt with the forget gate layer. Now let's talk about what we want to store in this, what we are going to store in the cell state. Okay. As an input, again, we are taking the X of T and H of T minus one as two inputs. First, it will pass on to the sigmoid layer. So as I mentioned, it will be done in two steps, a sigmoid layer and other will be a 10H layer. Sigmoid layer decides which values we will update, and 10H layer creates a vector of candidate values that could be added to the state. So these two layers will decide what information we will be passing on to the cell state. And in the next step, in the part 2A, this 2A, in 2B, we will combine these two to create an update to the cell state. Okay. So in the first step, we discussed about the what we want to throw away. In the next step two, we discussed about what we want to store. We will combine these two information in the next step. In this step, you can see that we have combined these two steps to give an update to the cell state. And essentially, we are doing this. We multiply the old state with C of T minus one with F of T, which we did in first step. And then we add this new information, I of T and C, and the candidate value C of T, which are the new candidate values that scale down by how much we want to update. So it's an intuitive explanation. This is how we kind of address. In case of our example of language model, this is the place where we actually drop the gender information about old person and add the new ones. Okay. So step one and two briefly talks about how we kind of maneuver or change the cell state. Let's move to the step three. Now, once we have done some updations in the cell state, we want to actually share the hidden state information to the next time step, right? Finally, we decide to what information we are going to output. Again, this is taken in two steps. First, the sigmoid layer, as you can see in the diagram, decides which part of the cell state we are going to output. Cell state information is updated in the previous two steps. Now, while passing the hidden state information, again, sigmoid layer comes in picture, which is inputted by the X of T and H of T minus one, and it decides what cell state information we should be outputting, right? And then put the cell state to 10H layer to push values between minus one and one. So just to squash it to a limit, we are passing it to 10H layer. And finally, multiply the output of sigmoid gate so that we only output parts which we decided. So this way, we combine the cell state information, pass it to the 10H layer, and multiply it with the output of sigmoid to get a hidden state information. This is how we pass on. This is how the entire, this is a simple LSTM architecture. There are different variants of it. We also have GRUs. This is how typically the LSTM components work in conjunction. And we have four neural network layers which are kind of working together. I'll take a pause here if anyone has a question about these steps.
No, not yet.
Okay. just a recap. In in step one, we talked about throwing away self-state information using the concept of forget gate layer. And in step two, we talked about what information we want to store using two layers, sigmoid layer and 10H layer, which will retain whatever information that we want. In case of our gender example, we want to retain the gender information of the current person instead of the previous one. And we in the step 2b, we are actually combining this information to update the cell state. And finally, what we want to output, we are kind of working on that. And it is done in two steps. First, we pass on to the sigmoid layer, and the cell state gets passed on to 10H layer for squashing the values between -1 and 1. We multiply these values to output finally the hidden state information to the next timestamp. Okay, this was the walkthrough of an LSTM network. Let's talk about the applications of LSTM and where it can be applied. So wherever we have a sequence, wherever we want to decide or predict something in something that is current basis the previous information, I think LSTMs can be applied. Wherever we have a sequential structure of data, I think the LSTMs will be the first thing you should be trying out, right? So with that information, you can work with stop predictions. You can also work with text generation, like lyrics. If you have a set of data of lyrics, you can pass on to the LSTM network to generate the further lyrics. You can also kind of pass on the Shakespeare writings, and you can mimic that Shakespeare writing by passing on to LSTM, and it will start producing poetries for you basis what you have passed on as a training data. What else? What I think language translation, Google Translate is a very good example. I think this use case is kind of something booming, because language translations are an important part. It is being used everywhere. Speech recognition, right? Speech recognition is also nowadays a boom. If you have heard about a company called rephrase.ai, maybe you can Google after this session. They are really working on something on speech. What they are essentially doing is they will take the scripts from, say, their vendors or their clients, sorry, and they will read out the script by machine. So you give in the text and it will read out that text and in the form of audio, and it will be so human like that it will feel that a person is sitting next to you, right? So they are using generative adversarial networks, GANs, for doing that. Maybe you can I'm just putting a thought there, but you can kind of deep dive into what are this company is doing, rephrase.ai. What next? Handwritten digit recognition is a common use case that you can use. Image captioning is something a lot of people, it is impressive and attractive. What essentially it is doing. So in the image captioning example, you can think about passing on an image, and in terms of a sentence or a sequence of words, it will tell me what exactly that picture is about. So if a person is holding a bat and kind of striking a bat, it will give in the form of words what exactly the person is doing. So basically it is captioning the image. Again, this is a very good use case to work on. Let's talk about one or two use cases in detail. I'll majorly talk about text generation and language translation precisely. Any questions here?
Sir, LSTMs are used only for text data?
No, LSTMs can be used for structured data as well, like stock prediction.
But if you want to use...
Sorry, your voice is feeble. Sorry.
If you want to use for image data.
Yeah, you can pass on the you can stack the CNN stack along with an LSTM stack, right? You can do that as well.
Hello,
CNN
sir.
Stage, you convolve karlo and then pass on that information to LSTM. Yeah. Next question, please.
Hello, sir. If I want to find out and detect whether the given views are fake or not, so will the LSTM the best one for this?
Can you come again? Sorry, just I missed
your first sentence. Find out the reviews which are, for example, on the Amazon, the reviews for the products. I want to find out whether they are fake or they are real. So for that purpose, can I use the LSTM?
You can use it, but do you have the training data for it? Like, if the sentence is fake, do you have a training data annotated that this sentence is a fake and this sentence is a truth? If you have a very good data set where you have annotations or labeling of fake and truth, yes, definitely. Essentially, what we want to do is we want to see a sequence of words. We are working. The game is all about sequence of words. So, yeah, definitely you can use LSTM.
Sir, what is the ideal size of input training data we need to give?
Input training data, I think there is no ideal size, but depends on the number of intents or targets or categories that you have. So I would say that start with 100 samples per intent per category, I would say. And grow as you have more data, you will have a better F1 score or accuracy, which I would say. Does it answer your question?
Okay.
Category or intent means, let's take about sentiment analysis. So, in sentiment analysis, what category do we have? Positive, negative, neutral. So, what I'm saying is positive. 100 samples, negative 100 samples, neutral 100 samples. But in the real world, you will not get this kind of distribution. You will have positive reviews 100, negative reviews 20, neutral reviews 30. So they will have a class imbalance as well. So again, that's a different story. You have to work on the class balancing aspect.
Sir, can we do data generation, natural data generation? I mean, if we have only 20 negative reviews, is it advisable to give it to LSTM to generate new data of negative type?
So what if there's a class imbalance, then forget about LSTMs. Other models will also fail, right? We need to have a good distribution of data points, right, across different categories. Only then I think you'll be able to build a good model. Else, let's say if you have the data set is huge in millions, right? What you can do is, let's say data set is in millions and your majority category is around 98% of data, right? But even that 2% minority is in terms of thousands, right? So better you scale down or up down sample your majority data to the level of minority. So let's say 98,000 data points belongs to the majority class, let's say positive, and 2,000 records belongs to the negative review. So if you want to build a model just to try out like a first draft, what you can do is you can downsample your positive class from 90 to 2,000. So you can pick up random data points or records or reviews, whatever you call, from 98,000 up to 2,000. 2,000 samples you pick up from a lot of 98,000. So what you essentially have now is 2,000 samples of positive reviews, 2,000 samples of negative reviews. You can build a model from this first and then see that. It should be a proper balance. Even 60-40 would do. 60% positive review, 40% negative review, and you can build a model. Yeah.
So, sir, actually, I was asking, can we do data augmentation? I mean, by generating, say, if I'm having only 20 negative reviews, and maybe if I go with LSTM and generate based on that 20, can I do augmentation on that 20 to scale it up to maybe 100? Or it will be...
Yeah, so there are various implementations. What you're saying is basically upsampling. So let's say if it's 100 is to 20, and you want to bring the 20 to some better number, increase the samples. So what you can do is you can apply various implementations by generating synthetic data. One such package in Python, if you are familiar with Python, is Smote, S-M-O-T-E. It talks about generating synthetic examples from your existing 20 negative data set. So you can do that, yeah. I mean, there are other implementations as well for upsampling data. Right now, what I can recollect and I know is about Smote, S-M-O-T-E, Smote, Python implementation. Yeah. You can do the data augmentation part to answer your question.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Let me start with the example section. Okay. So what text generation is? So generating a text can be converted into an LSTM task where each letter is generated considering all the previous generated letters. So if I have to take a very basic example, if I pass on the letters A, B, C, D up to Z and train the LSTM network on this. So what it will, if I pass on as a prediction, if I pass on A, it should give me answer as B, right? That's what we are doing in the text generation part. And we can also train in different sizes. Let's say if I pass on, let's say if my training data is A, B, C, D as X and D as Y. Then again, D, E, F as X and G as target. So you can pass on the training data the way you want. And when you predict, let's say you give the input as A, B, C, it should output D. That is what essentially is the text generation simplified version. Passing on this data to LSTM network. LSTM will learn the sequence patterns, and once you pass on anything, any input information, it will predict basis that sequence information that it has learned, and it will generate the output. Okay. Again, it's a simple sequence prediction problem where we can train the network. Let's say learn alphabets, and then later can be generalized to other sequence prediction problem like time series prediction and sequence classification. Let's now see different regimes of sequence where you can think about using RNN and LSTMs. Okay, this is a wonderful explanation by Andrej Karpathy. I just want you to kind of take a look on this for 5 seconds. Okay. What you see in the first diagram is a simple neural network in fixed sized input passed on to hidden vectors and then generating an output, a fixed size output. Where this can be used is an image classification where you pass on an image and you generate an output basis that image, right? You classify cats and dogs, right? For a simple example, you pass on the cat image, it will learn that it's a cat and it will output in terms of word that it's a cat. That's a simple neural network using image classification. Let's see if we have a fixed sized input and the output is somewhat a sequence or a word sequence. Where this can be used? Image captioning, right? You pass on an image and as in terms of word, it will depict what it has seen in the image. So this is a one to many kind of relation, where you can see how the hidden vectors are passing on this information and where LSTM and RNN can be used. Let's talk about sentiment analysis. So what exactly? You are passing on a sentence, let's say a food review, and you want to see if it's good or bad. So you will pass on a sequence of words and you get a fixed sized output, say bad or good. So input is sequence input, output is a fixed output. Let's talk about many-to-many relationship where you're passing a sequence input and getting a sequence output. Again, machine translation. Pass on something in English, you'll get in French, German, Hindi, Gujarati, whatever you want. And that's machine translation kind of a use case. Let's talk about something different. We have synced input and output. I think this can be visualized in a video classification where you're passing each frames as an input, and it is giving me classifying in terms of words, right? This is a many-to-many kind of a relationship. Okay, with that, let me pass on to the next slide. Let's talk about RNN character level language model, where the idea is to pass on a sequence of letters, characters, and generate the letter coming subsequent next to it. So let's say we have a training data of word hello, and our vocabulary is of size 4, H-E-L-O, right? How it will typically work in the RNN scenario, right? What we do first is we take 4 words of our vocabulary, H-E-L-O, and one hot encoded, right? So H is kind of, there's a one, I don't think I need to explain one hot encoding if you know already that it will kind of enable one of the dimension of a four dimension vector. So H is taken by the first one, E is by the second, and subsequently L, the third one. And finally, if you see the top right corner, O is taken by the last dimension, right? So we have one hot encode the input layer and pass on this to the RNN, and it will work through the hidden layer. And one thing that I wanted you to notice is as we pass input layer H, and as you see the output layer, you can see that 2.2 is being highlighted, and it has learned that next word is E, right? And E represents a second dimension where it is 1. So 2.2 is highlighted. Next, if you pass E, it is highlighting L. Again, it is minus 1. Essentially, it should have been 1.2 that should be highlighted. But since this is a first run, in the subsequent backpropagation runs, it will learn to adjust this weight. As you move forward, if you pass on L, in the last time step, it will highlight O, that is 2.2.2. And the hidden layers are giving all this information as a context to this, right? Yes. Any questions on this? If I have confused this, we will have a better explanation on this.
No.
Okay. Just to summarize what I was trying to explain here is that given a training word hello, and if you have 4 characters, if I want to predict, if I give H-E-L-L, I want to see if it is able to predict the O part, right? It is working on a character, right? So as we passed H, it highlighted E. As we passed E, it highlighted L. Similarly, lastly, when I passed L, it should highlight the O-th dimension of my one hot encoded vector, which it is doing, at least in this depiction, right? This is how you will work with the RNN character level language models. That's what I wanted to kind of explain in this slide. This is again text generation examples. Okay. Now comes the interesting part, that is language translation. Before I move to this slide, I'll take a 5-second pause if you have any questions. Okay, let's discuss about language translation. Before I jump into this example, what I want to introduce is a new architecture which has an encoding layer and a decoding layer. And in the sequence to sequence model algorithm, you would find this kind of architecture where we have an encoder and a decoder. The encoder kind of goes through all the words that we have in the input sequence. It will generate a context, compress this information in terms of a vector, and pass this vector information to the decoder so that at every time step it can look at that context and generate outputs. So let me run this video for a quick GIF. It is, you can see how it is going. It has passed on the hidden information. Now it is taking this information and producing the translated answers, right? Encoded for some other language, and you got the output in the English sentence. So again, language translation can be viewed as a sequence to sequence problem, where we have sequence of different length, input sequence is different and output is different. It uses encoder decoder architecture, where the input and output sequence are different length. What it is essentially doing is it is using neural nets with an encoder to compress the text to a very higher abstract vector representation that I mentioned, and it passes on to decoder to decode it back to target language. That is essentially the encoder decoder architecture, which is used for neural machine translation. Again, in the present scenario, there are a lot of implementations where very heavy architectures are being used with different components. It started with this example, right? It started with the simple encoder decoder architecture, where the input sentence was kind of compressed into some higher abstract vector representation, and it was passed on to decoder. So with this, let's talk about the limitations of encoder decoder architecture. Sequence to sequence model with encoder decoder architecture performed well in various sequence application, but struggled with long sentences. In the previous video, you might have seen that once it has seen all the input sequences, all the words, it kind of generates a compressed vector representation and it passes to decoder. But if the sentences are long, then that context vector becomes long as well. And that's the problem with this current setup. So the encoder converts the entire input sequence into fixed length vector, and decoder predicts the output sequence. All this works great with shorter sequences, since the decoder is looking at the entire input sequence for prediction. But for long sentences, sequences, it is difficult to memorize the long sequence into a fixed length vector. So that was a problem with this encoder decoder architecture. And what we wanted is some mechanism where it will pay a special attention to the components of that context vector and not to the entire context vector, right? And hence we came up with the concept called as attention mechanism, right? In the encoder decoder architecture, one new thing that was introduced was attention. It is different with the normal architecture of encoder decoder in two ways that I'll explain here. Just to explain this image, if I had to pass that same example, in this example with attention, it would have paid special attention to the word student. That is what it is being shown in this diagram, right? So let's talk about how it is different than the other sequence to sequence model. First, it was introduced by Badanu and Luong between 2014-15 of this 2014-15, and it was called a technique called attention was introduced and refined. It allows the model to focus on the relevant part of the input sequence as needed, and as you can see in this English in this example of language translation, it pays a special attention to word student before it generates into English translation. So let me focus on the two parts that it is different than the normal sequence to sequence models. First part, let me run this video. See, now it has passed all three hidden states instead of just the entire context of it, right? It has passed a lot more information to the decoder. Earlier it was just passing the hidden state 3, but in this case it has passed all the hidden states to the decoder for to have a better understanding, and it will use this information in a very different way with attentions. Let's go to the second aspect of it and how it is different than the normal one. First was that it passes more information. It passes all three hidden states. Let's move to the second part on how it is differing. Okay. Here you can see, just to explain what this means here, how it is different. We got the hidden state information from the encoder, right? Now we're discussing about a decoder aspect and how it is, what it essentially it is working and how it is working. So we have got hidden state information. We generate these codes for each hidden state. Again, attention does some magic there with query key and value vectors and generates this score, right? And once the scores are generated, we apply a softmax operation, a softmax function, so that we highlight the ones which are greater or larger and faint out the ones which are smaller. So softmax will essentially do that and help me do that. So in the next step, we multiply the softmax score with the hidden vectors. And so it will faint out the ones which are not useful for me. So maybe when I'm passing on this hidden state information in the decoder step for my first word is outputting. So I want this first hidden vector to be highlighted and then other words to be fainted. So this way we are achieving this. And once this is done, we will add these weights to a context vector. I mean, we'll generate a context vector by adding these hidden state weights, right? And this will be used in the next, this will be used for the next step. So just to summarize, in the first step, we passed on hidden state information for all three words or all word sequences. And once we receive that word sequences, in this step, we are doing some calculations and manipulations by multiplying the softmax score, generating the attention weights for each hidden state, softmaxing it, then some adding this into a context vector, creating context vector out of it. Okay, let me play this video, which will make this concept more concrete. So from the encoder, we've already received H1, H2, H3. See how it is done. So it has fainted out the others, and that context vector is passed on to the hidden state information that we have received. And this word will be used in the next step. Okay, so just to explain this, what it is doing. Is my cursor visible to you guys?
Yes.
Okay. So in the decoder step, it will have a hidden state initialization, let's say 000s. It will pass on along with the end token word. It will generate a hidden intermediate hidden information. This is all decoder, right? This H4 is being concatenated with the context information received from the attention, right? And this is being passed on to feed forward neural network, and then it decides, okay, the word is I for my whatever different language word that it had provided. The decoded element for that is I. Now with this I information being passed on to the next word, okay, and this hidden state information and the next word information is passed, H5 is generated, and using this H5 and using the attention mechanism, we have concatenated the context for the word, second word, that is M, and the hidden state information. After this concatenation, we passed on to the feed forward neural network and generated word M, right? This way, it generates the other sequences as well for the words. So what it has referred from the normal traditional encoder decoder architecture is that this attention frames, right? So attention frames are paying special attention to the word that we want to actually kind of highlight. So this was it with the sequence models with attention. Let me move to next slide. Okay, we have come to a conclusion. So what we have discussed, we have built intuition on how LSTMs work. We have understood the sequence models and its application in text. And lastly, we look at the attention mechanism in the sequence models, right? As we saw just in the last slide. Oh, what we'll be doing next is we'll be talking about, we'll be going through the code walkthrough of some of these examples. We'll see how lyrics generation can be done using sequence-to-sequence model. We will take an example of a neural machine translation from German to English. And lastly, this is an interesting team or a company called Hugging Face, which has kind of democratized the way we are using this language models. It has kind of given a repository of different trained models to use, and we can simply use to achieve the end task. So we'll see a text summarization implementation using the Hugging Face library, Hugging Face implementation. Hugging Face has actually released a library called Transformers. We'll be using that library. So before we move on to this code implementations, any questions?
One question is there in chat. LSTM can be used for image data?
Yes, I think I've already answered that.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So, these links that I'm sharing, I think these links are wonderful articles. You guys are a PhD students. I think you are more well versed with the research papers. But I think just to add on to what you read from research papers, you can also go through these articles. I think whatever slides that I've prepared, it's basically a sense of all these articles and wonderful animations and visualizations. So please go through this. I also want to talk about or highlight transformers now. Again, I mean, as we move forward, there are different implementations and more accurate implementations are coming up. And in that line, after discussing attention, the next logical thing to discuss is transformers. So do check out what transformers mean from this amazing article by Jay Alamar. I've attached this link to here, a link here. Just to give a kind of a quick understanding. So transformers, again, is an implementation where you use multi-head attentions, and it enables parallelization so that you have faster implementation, faster outputs. And you can actually use DPUs while using transformers. So do check this article on in terms of how this is different than the typical attention mechanism. Okay. If there are no questions, we can move to the code walkthrough. Okay. Let me know if we can start with the coding exercise. Yeah.
Yes, we can start with it.
Okay. Okay. So I think what I'll be doing is I'm not running these steps because it will take some time. So I'll just give you the walkthrough of what exactly it is happening in this. I'm not sure how good the audience is in Python, so it would be difficult to explain line by line, but do point out if you want any explanation on any end, right? So the typical Python implementation works in the form of some libraries. So Python is library driven. We need to import all the relevant modules, or you can say libraries, before we start implementing. What I'll be using is TensorFlow, and I'll be importing the Keras is a kind of a wrapper around TensorFlow, which provides some important utilities to run different elements of this model. So we are kind of importing the embedding layer, the LSTM layers, the bidirectional implementation. We are also, just to pre-process text, we will not be getting this data in a clean format. The sentence size will also differ. So we'll be using the pad sequences. So, and again, optimizer, you can use ADAM optimizer. Okay, these are the library import segments.
Sir, can we use our own tokenizer?
Yes.
Okay.
You can implement your own tokenizer. Need not be using Keras tokenizer. Yeah. You can try your own tokenizer as well. It's just that how you actually code it, right? So you need to ensure that whatever you're passing to your data in the subsequent runs, it should not be a problem. Tokenizer can be yours as well. Yeah. We'll download this data. Again, this article and this implementation was taught by Lawrence Moroni in one of the Coursera courses, where he's actually kind of generating lyrics, given a text as an input, right? So once we have this data, what we do is tokenize. Tokenize is basically divide a word sequence, the sentences into words. So that basically kind of creating n-grams or chunks of words given a sentence. A good NLP word would be tokenized for that. Okay. Once we do that, what we can see in the output is we are assigning indexes. So each word will get some number. Dog gets one, and gets two, and likewise, all the words in my lyrics will get some identifier in terms of numbers. So, and the total words, our vocabulary size is 2690. These are the amount of words that we have in our entire lyrics data. Okay. Now, what I want to do is, in my corpus, I want to convert the text into sequences, right? And sequence as in, how would I say? Okay. So let's say if I have a sentence and I love NLP, I know that I belong to a certain number, love belongs to some word index, and NLP belongs to some certain index. So my one line will be my vector of those numbers, right? So that way I'm creating sequences of numbers given each line in my corpus, each line in my lyrics data. That way I'll generate that. Okay. Corpus is nothing but a list of list. Sentence, comma, sentence, comma, sentence. You can visualize that way. And take each line, generate sequence, and then append to my sequence list. Okay. And one thing that I want to highlight is about pad sequences. So not each line will have same number of words, right? Some line will have five words, some line will have three words. So we need to add some zeros in the beginning or at the end, right? So what we will be doing is, first, let me see in my input sequence list, what is the maximum length of any line. So if you have in the input sequence, there are 10 lines and the maximum line is 9 words, let's say. One sentence is of 9 words. So what I'll do is I'll take that maximum number 9 in my max sequence length and then start adding zeros to all the other lines where the number of words are not 9. So 5 words will be my words and 6, 7, 8, 9 will be my zeros, right? Let me show it. So if I have a word like I love NLP, okay, I have converted into sequence, which is 32 64, 43, 54, 67. So I belongs to the word 43, love belongs to 54, NLP belongs to 67 that I have done to convert sequence. Now I know that there is some sentence which is longer than this. So let's say that max sequence length is 5. I'll add zeros at the end. Either you can add it at the end or you can add the beginning. The padding is given pre, so it is adding at the beginning. So I'll add at the beginning. Okay. Why we are doing this is because the way this implementation works, it expects a fixed sized vector. It cannot be like all the input sentences are of different length, right? The NumPy operation will fail in that case. Hence, it requires a padding of zeros at the beginning or at the end. That is something that you can configure. Okay, this is what we are doing here. Also, we are kind of using this two categorical. So we need to have this labels as well. Okay, tell me what will be the labels in this case. Labels will be the next sentence, right? Basically, what we are doing is we are generating lyrics, right? So as I've explained in the example of alphabet generation, how it will work is input is A, output is B. Input is B, output is C. Input is C, output is D. So if you provide this kind of data to my LSTM, just an audio check, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So if I provide this kind of data to my LSTM, and then suddenly I'll ask, okay, predict for C, what should be the output? D, right? I want the LSTM to learn this pattern of sequences. Similarly, I'll pass on the lyrics in terms of sentences. So sentence one will go one here, sentence two will go here, sentence two will go here, and sentence three will go there, right? Something like this. So when I pass on sentence two, it should output sentence three. Right. Okay. So this is how we are kind of breaking down our dataset into these forms that I've explained. This is just an example of word index. So what is the index value of in my dataset? So it is 8. The identifier for in my word index dictionary is 8. That is what we have here. And this is one example of one sentence. So this one sentence in my data is padded with zeros and then two. So if you have some different sentence, it will have some different values in here. Similarly with my target. My target also have some zeros. It will have some intermediate value here. It's a huge long list, hence it is just shown in a form like this, where we have dot dots in between, right? One more example of our input sentence encoded into numbers is this, right? Pre-padded with zeros. Let's say I have explained now, one, I love NLP, how it has given some numbers. It has given some numbers to the input sentences as well. Okay, here comes the crux. What I'm doing here is I'm creating a sequential layer. It is just an implementation of how Keras works. If you want to implement a LSTM for lyrics generation, we have an embedding layer where we pass on these words to the embedding layer. This in turn passes to the LSTM. We are using bidirectional here because we want the sequence to be learned from left to right and as well as right to left. Okay, it works better if we have a bidirectional layer. So next we are passing this to feed forward neural network, that is the dense layer. So LSTM is done, Next comes the feed forward neural network. So that on that we'll apply a softmax. Softmax will help me output the correct category. In our case, the correct sentence, next sentence, or lyrics. That should be coming if we give some portion of lyrics as an input, right? Again, compile, we have a categorical cross entropy. Essentially, what we're doing is what should be the next best sentence given an input sentence. We are kind of dividing into categories. And it will give a softmax score for each category. The highest one will be shown as an output, right? We train it with 10 epochs and it runs, and then we can see some accuracy chart, and it goes up to 70% accuracy on 10 epochs. Here comes the part where I was discussing. So now the model is ready. I want to predict the lyrics, right? I want to generate lyrics given some placeholder or some seed text. So my seed text is, I have got a bad feeling about this. Now it should auto complete, right? It should complete the upcoming words. So it is interesting to see what kind of poetry or lyrics it is generating. So it is generating, I have got a bad feeling about this day. On her lips lays her finger and dancing blue away to her house. So it will not totally make sense, right? Because we have used just 10 epochs. And we can kind of work out with this layers here. We can add more LSTM layers, we can add dropouts, and we can try different things here to improve the accuracy. And again, we are asking them to predict next 100 words. Maybe we can try just for 10 words and see how it is performing. So this is how we can generate lyrics given an input seed text, right? Any questions on this implementation? Then we can move on to the machine translation aspect.
So I think there are no questions. Yes, so we can
move. Okay. So this was one example of sequence to sequence model for lyrics generation. Let's move to another example of machine translation. Again, I'll not be running because it takes a lot of time to run. Here, we are using this encoder-decoder concept. Again, we are importing certain libraries. We'll be doing the same pre-processing steps of padding sequence and tokenizing the inputs, lowercasing the words, and all of that stuff. For that, we have imported certain libraries, certain modules. We are reading in the .txt file, and we are doing some pre-processing. We are splitting a text into sentences by let's say slash n. So the entire text in a file would be separated by slash n, and we are splitting it into by using slash n so that we have a list of list, right? So we have a sentence list. It's nothing but a list of lists, okay? Or I think list of lists, right? What we are getting here is the data, right? We are downloading this data, unzipping it, reading the data, and then let's visualize how it looks, right? The data size is huge. It has 150,000 sentence pairs, but let's consider only 50,000 sentence pairs. How it is paired is, we have word in English and we have a corresponding word in German. It is also called as Deutsch, right? So similarly, English and German pair. This is the data for to input in our model. What we do, some pre-processing in terms of removing some punctuations, right? So we do that here. Again, visualize this data, then convert this into lowercase because you don't want to have a different representation of same words. So one, let's say Boston is in like this form, and again somewhere in the sentence we have capital letters in Boston. We don't want to have a different form, same words. We want to, everything should be lowercase. So we lowercase that. Then again, text to sequence conversion that we discussed, converting it into numbers and then bringing it into a list. One visualization we can see is that the maximum length of the German sentence is 11. So German sentence maximum is 11. After 10, there's nothing available. And the maximum length of English phrases is 8. So the maximum is like 8 words sentences that we can see here. If you see the x-axis though. Okay, let's use the tokenizer. Tokenize these sentences into words. That's what we're doing. We use tokenizer for English and Dutch both. And we see the vocabulary size. So English vocabulary size is around 6241. We have 6,000 words in our English vocabulary. And for German, we have around 10,000. Let's do the encoding and pad sequence steps, text to sequence, and then pre-padding or post-padding, in this case, some numbers that we do here. Going forward, what we're doing here is that we're splitting the data into two data sets, that is test and train, just to kind of validate how it is performing. We are doing this here. We are creating a training set and a validation set. Now comes the part where we are applying an encoder decoder architecture. So again, bringing up the sequential layers, sequential model, and adding the layers into it. First, we add the embedding layer. Then we go with the LSTM units, which is our encoder. Once we have received the encoder architecture, we want to pass the context to the decoder architecture. But let's say decoder architecture has, let's say, 5 words, right, to translate. Then whatever information that we are getting from the LSTM, whatever context we're getting, we want to repeat that context 5 times. Hence, we use the repeat vector. So it will give each word the same output, same vector representation of the LSTM layer, right? And hence we have a repeat vector in between. The decoder LSTM will take this hidden information from the repeat vector and generate output. Whatever output is being generated, we have returned the sequence true. This return sequence information that we get is passed on to the feed forward neural network, which will finally generate me the translated values, right, using softmax layer. Again, we are using an optimizer here to optimize and reach out to converge to the optimum value. And then we have some, then we are running the this model along with generating checkpoints. Okay, so wherever the save bash only true is given. This takes a lot of time, so I'm not running this. This runs for almost 30 epochs and took some good amount of time. As you can see in the plots, the loss is, the validation loss is kind of improving up to 30 epochs. And you can see that it is fine, right? Once we have this model, we will load it again. And now using this model, we want to predict. In given the input sentence in, let's say, German language, Dutch language, we want to predict in English. So these next steps essentially is doing the same thing. It will do the same pre-processing step which we did for training, and will convert into English. So this is the conversion step. So let's see in the data frame format where we have the actual and where we have the predicted, right? We just train the model only on the training set, but we kept some portion for validation, right? So this is what we are kind of validating now. You can see that not all of them have been translated perfectly, right? I said good morning, it is predicting I ate wrong. Right Tom was correct. It's too dark is also correct. It's not always easy. It's not, right? So again, this is not an accurate implementation. maybe you can try using attention-based mechanism. In this, we have not used attention-based mechanism here, but you can try on that. This was just a simple encoding-decoding architecture where we pass the entire context information from encoder to decoder without attention. But still, it did a decent job in tried converting, translating German to English, right? What I'm attaching below is the attention implementation. One is in TensorFlow, other is in PyTorch. So do have a look. Again, it's more of a Python implementation. If you have a good grasp of Python, you will get the understanding of how these are being implemented. But it is coming directly from the TensorFlow website and PyTorch website. So I think it is a good read, I believe. Okay, any questions in this? Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible. So I think no questions yet.
Cool. Lastly, very simple and basic thing that I want to showcase is the Hugging Face implementation. So again, Hugging Face is a website where you get all the pre-trained models, latest models. If you're not aware of it, then this is something that you need to check and often visit. You can see a lot of models for different tasks they have shared, and you can kind of use these models using the Transformers library. And one such example of text summarization is that we will be seeing. And you can see with just few lines of code how good it is showcasing the result. We need to install certain things. That is, the main thing is Transformers library, and generate a pipeline. In that pipeline, we are saying that we want to achieve a summarization task. So it will build a summarizer object for you. What we want to summarize is this article, right? It's a huge article of, let's say, thousands of words, I believe. And we want to summarize this, okay? What we want to do is pass on the article, pass on some attributes, and then get a summary of it. You can see with just one line of code, it has done so many things in the background, and it has generated the summary text. It's not viable for me to read this entire thing and read this summary as well, but just to explain you that you can also use this library, understand what it's doing, and with just few lines of code, you can achieve this implementation of summary. Summarization. Likewise, you can also import certain models. Let's say I want to translate certain sentences. So what I want to do is, this English sentence should be translated into French. This sentence should be translated into Portuguese, and this in Spanish, right? So we can load these models. One of these models, maybe the contributor name is this is or something of that sort, who have contributed to Hugging Face. They have released this model where you can import directly from Transformers. You can provide the source text, and you can load this model. But I think we are loading tokenizer here, and we are loading the model in the next step. So we can load the tokenizer, load the model using this Transformers library, create an input source text, and just translate it. So in the translated part, you can see I've printed, it has generated the output, right? It is this simple. What all supported languages it has? It has given all the supported languages here. I think it's an abbreviation. SPA is maybe Spanish and FRA
is French. Is your Indian language, any Indian language except Hindi supported? Any ideas, sir?
So again, in this particular Marian MT model, maybe not, but there are so many other models here. you can see multilingual models. Yeah, you can check any of the multilingual models for utilizing translations, right? There are definitely there. Let me tell you that there are multiple models available for Hindi language. Do check. There are code mixing languages models as well. It is available. Just to answer your question. This is not, in this we are not showing anything in Hindi. Maybe I think this IND is something we can check. I'm not sure if I reconnect quickly, it will run for me or not. Let me try. Till then, if you have any questions, you can ask questions. I am trying to connect and run. No questions. Hope you guys are with me, right? Or this thing is visible, right? The screen?
Yes.
I don't think this is Hindi. That IND is not Hindi. I thought it is Hindi. So yeah, it's not available in at least in this package. Okay, but there are implementations available online. You can try out.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Yeah, that's it from my side. Please let me know if you have any questions.
So if anyone is having questions, please you can ask.
If you don't have any questions, please write down on these values in for the data science and reach out on these numbers if you have any questions.
So we can connect with you on these contact. So
you can connect with the data science wizards team at this particular address, and they will route it to me if it is ready to me.
Okay. So I think everyone is satisfied because no questions are coming. So thank you so much, sir, for the session, and especially that you have, I think, in very short time of span, with last week only we have connected with you, and you agreed to take the session. So thank you so much for that.
Yeah.
It is a very good session. So thank you, Sushri ma'am. So in future we would be we would like to associate with you for further workshops. So we'll contact you for that.
Yeah. You can contact, definitely. I think you can connect with the data science wizards team.
Yes.
And yes, we can definitely connect once again, and maybe so I can help in some other attributes.
Are coming? Yes. So it was an interesting session. The participants liked it very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And especially, I am clear with what is LSTM because I've never before this. I've never read it about it. So
okay.
I am aware of that, but LSTM I was not much aware of.
That is great. It was I'm happy that it was helpful for everyone.
Yes, yes. It is actually. So thank you so much, sir.
Yeah. Welcome. Please post your questions if you have any to the email address that is being shared. And you can connect with me on LinkedIn as well. And if you have any questions, you can please we can discuss there. If I have time, I can reply. Yes. If you have specific queries, also I'm happy to answer.
Yes. So on LinkedIn, I have sent you a request.
Okay. I'll give a check. Just sure.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. So thank you so much, sir.
Yeah, welcome.
On behalf of the whole team, organizing team and committee, I thank you for this wonderful session.
Cool. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure and honor to serve you. Thank you.
So, dear participants, the next session will be at 1 p.m. So, we'll meet at 1 p.m.